Grace Church, and happy Mother's Day to all the ladies of Grace Church. This morning I'll be reading the first scripture from the book of the Acts, chapter 7. This describes the stoning of Saint Stephen. Stephen was a deacon chosen by the disciples to take care of widows and needy people. He was recognized as a saint and the first martyr in Christian theology. He was condemned to death for committing blasphemy against the Jewish people. Starting at verse 53 in the 7th chapter. And now you have betrayed and murdered him, you who have received the law that was put into effect through angels, but have not obeyed it. When they heard this, they were furious and gnashed their teeth at him. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, looked up to heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see heaven open and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. At this they covered their ears, and yelling at the top of their voices, they all rushed at him, dragged him out of the city, and began to stone him. Meanwhile, the witnesses laid their clothes at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were stoning him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he fell on his knees and cried out, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he died, and Saul was there giving approval to his death. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Reading from Psalm 35, 1 to 5, 15 to 16. Contend, Lord, with those who contend with me. Fight against those who fight against me. Take up shield and armor. Arise and come to my aid. Brandish spear and javelin against those who pursue me. Say to me, I am your salvation. May those who seek my life be disgraced and put to shame. May those who pilot my ruin be turned back in dismay. May they be like chaff before the wind, with the angel of the Lord driving them away. But when I stumbled, they gathered in glee. Assailants gathered against me without my knowledge. They slandered me without ceasing. Like the ungodly, they maliciously mocked. They gnashed their teeth at me. As many of the Psalms, there is a variety of emotion in this Psalm. And music for me has this emotion that I feel during this time. And I'd like to share with you a piece today by Liszt. The piece is a sonnet based on a poem. The poem is not about this particular Psalm, but I think it portrays many of the emotions that the psalmist is talking about in this Psalm.
Thank you.
second scripture from the New Testament is from 1 Peter chapter 2. Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation, now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone, rejected by men, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For in Scripture it says, "See, I lay a stone in Zion, a chosen and precious cornerstone. The one who trusts in him will never be put to shame. Now to you who believe, this stone is precious, but to those who do not believe, the stone the builders rejected has become the capstone, and a stone that causes men to stumble, and a rock that makes them fall. They stumble because they disobey the message, which is also what they were destined for. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Well, the days of our confinement are moving right along. We are at the fifth Sunday of Easter this week. So it's been more than a month since we celebrated Easter in our private places, away from the sanctuary at Grace Church. And today we come to a very familiar passage that the gospel writer John set down to record some of Jesus' last conversations and last words with his disciples before his crucifixion. They were intended to be encouraging and hopeful words for those who followed Jesus as they faced the difficulty that lay ahead of them. John chapter 14. "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father and we will be satisfied." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and still you do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask for anything, I will do it." The Gospel of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. It is said that General George Patton had great respect for Army chaplains. He always had them at staff meetings when important decisions were to be made. He was always calling on the chaplains to, quote, get a hotline to God. You may remember, if you've seen the 1970 movie entitled Patton, there was an exchange there at the Battle of the Bulge between General Patton and one of his chaplains. It was became a very well-known and famous one, and it was portrayed on the screen in that movie. During the Battle of the Bulge, the weather was so terrible that General Patton ordered the chaplain to write a prayer that would change the weather. The resulting prayer went something like this. Restrain these immoderate storms, O Lord. Grant us fair weather for battle. Graciously hearken to us as soldiers who call upon thee, that armed with thy power, we may advance from victory to victory and establish thy justice among men and nations. Amen. Well, General Patton received that prayer and gave it on December 12, 1944. It took God a few days to clear the weather, but Patton's army did advance from victory to victory, giving the appearance, at least, that even God could not say no to George Patton. Reverend Patrick Leary was rector of the Shrine of the Most Holy Redeemer in Las Vegas. He says visitors to the cathedral often make the same request of him. Father, will you pray for me to win? This is Las Vegas, remember? Father, will you pray for me to win? And he says his response is always the same. He points around him to the beautiful church and he says, I tell them, if it were that easy, do they think we'd still have a debt on this place? I believe in the power of prayer, he said, but even prayer has its limits. Even prayer has its limits. Isn't that interesting? Do you believe that prayer has its limits? Do you, what do you do then with these words of Jesus? If prayer has its limits, what do you do with Jesus' words that concluded the passage we just read, John 14? If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. That's what Jesus said. Think of the possibilities. If you ask of me anything in my name, I will do it. A new car, a new home, a cure for baldness. All we have to do is ask. If you ask me anything in my name, I will do it. Leslie Weatherhead said that when he was a high school student, he had a very difficult exam coming up, but he had discovered that verse in John 14, the verse with which Jesus concluded all the things he needed to tell his disciples and all of the hopeful things that he hoped to inspire in them. He had discovered that verse, whatsoever you ask in my name, that will I do. And he believed it. Weatherhead believed that verse meant that all he had to do was ask and he would pass the exam. So he told God that he was believing in God's promise and he wanted a good grade on the test. The next day, young Weatherhead took the exams, and when the grades came in, he had flunked it. He was disillusioned. He rebelled, lost his faith for a while. He came to the conclusion that the promises of the Bible were no good. The promises of God weren't worth anything. The next year, he repeated the course. He worked hard, and he passed. This time, he decided that he didn't need God, that he could get along by himself. It took Leslie Weatherhead some years to understand that his own powers and abilities to think and understand were in reality the power that God had given to him. He began to realize that God had already given him the power to pass the exam, but he had not used that very power on the first go-round. Have you heard that old joke? It's often repeated about a fella who was at home by himself when torrential rains and rising rivers caused a great flood in his area that threatened his house. And he called upon God to rescue him, to save him. And he got a response, an immediate response. I will save you. And so he was confident in God's promise that he would be rescued from the flood. Before long, he heard a knock on the door. Some fellas in a truck were coming by. The water was already up to the axles of the truck. They came, come, sir, get in the truck. We've come to take you and your neighbors away. So, no, I'm fine. God has promised to save me. I'm staying right here till God comes to get me. So the truck went on while the water kept rising. When the water got up to the ceiling in the first level of his house, some fellas came along in a boat, said, come, jump in the boat. We've got room for you. We'll get you out of here. The waters are still coming up. The flood is bigger than we expected. No, I'm fine. He said, as he looked at them out the second floor window, I'm fine. God has promised to rescue me. I'm staying right here till God comes. Well, the waters kept rising. And pretty soon he had to climb out onto the roof. He was on the peak of the roof, clinging to the chimney. When a helicopter came by, they dropped a ladder and sent a man down. We've come to rescue you. Climb up the ladder with me. We'll get you out of here. No. God will rescue me. God has promised. I'm staying right here till God comes to save me. Well, the floodwaters kept rising, and the man was swept away, and he died. When he appeared before God in heaven, he said, I don't understand, Lord. I prayed and I heard your answer distinctly. You would come to save me. And God looked at him and said, well, I sent a truck, a boat, and a helicopter to get you. I don't know what else I could have done. If you ask me anything in my name, Jesus said, I will do it. Quite a claim. And it tempts us to trust God in ways that God didn't intend, and to hear Jesus and expect things of Jesus that Jesus was not offering. Let's examine that statement just a little bit closer. First of all, notice that Jesus is talking to his disciples in this entire dialogue, which we read from John 14. He's speaking to those who were his closest followers. And he says, whoever believes in me, the works that I do, he or she will do also. Greater works than these, they will do. And whatever you ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Jesus is giving his disciples words of encouragement. You've seen the blind recover their sight. You've seen the lame walk. You're going to do greater things than that. Jesus was talking to the church. He was not talking about new houses or new cars or passing examinations. He was talking about the work of God's kingdom, the work that he called his disciples to do, the work that they had seen him accomplish. You will do greater things than these. He was talking to the church, and he was talking about God's kingdom. Not about new cars, new houses, or passing exams. He was talking about the work of God's kingdom. He was saying that when the disciples decide to get into action, the work that God has called them to do, the work that they have seen accomplished in and through Jesus, nothing will be out of their reach. But there's something else that's just as important. Jesus adds a qualifier. He says, and whatever you ask in my name, he promises, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified, that God may be glorified. Christ will do anything we ask if it glorifies God. Here is where we generally stumble. Not everything that we do, not even everything that we do in the church, is done to the glory of God. Isaac Asimov told a hilarious story about Rabbi Feldman, who was having trouble with his congregation. They seemed to be unable to agree on anything. They were always arguing. The president of the congregation finally had enough of it one day, and he said, Rabbi, we cannot continue this way. Come, there must be a conference. We must settle all our areas of dispute once and for all. And the rabbi agreed. At the appointed time, The rabbi, the president, and 10 elders met in the conference room of the synagogue, sitting about a magnificent mahogany table, to clarify and to solve their differences. One by one, each of the issues was discussed and dealt with. And on each issue, it became more and more apparent that the rabbi was the lonely voice in the wilderness. He felt one way, everybody else had a different idea. The president of the synagogue finally said, "Come, Rabbi, enough of this. Let us vote and allow the majority to rule and be finished." He passed out slips of paper, and each person present made their mark. The slips were collected, and the president said, "You may examine them, Rabbi. It is 11 to 1 on every count, 11 to 1 against you. We have the majority. The issues are settled." Whereupon the rabbi rose to his feet in offended majesty. "So," he said, "you now think because of the vote that you are right and I am wrong. Well, that is not so. I stand here," and he raised his arms impressively, "I stand here to call upon the Holy One of Israel to give us a sign that I am right and you are wrong." As he said that, came a frightful crack of thunder and a brilliant flash of lightning that struck the mahogany table and cracked it in two. The room was filled with smoke and fumes, and the president and the elders were hurled to the floor. Through all of that mayhem, the rabbi remained erect and untouched, his eyes flashing, a grim smile on his face. Slowly, the president of the synagogue lifted himself above what was left of the table. His hair was singed. His glasses were hanging from one ear. His clothing was in disarray. And finally, he said, "All right, 11 to 2, but we still have the majority." We all know that not everything that is done in the church is done to the glory of God. But wouldn't it be something if we had a dream for our church that was big enough to hold all of us in, and so big that we would have to depend upon God to accomplish it? And wouldn't it be something if we searched our hearts and our souls with prayer so that our dream could match God's great dream? I think the folks at Grace Church have already discovered that. And we've already taken some marvelous steps in that direction with a dream to stay where we are, a dream to stay alive that is responsive to God's call to us and God's great dream for our community and our world. And we've discovered already in the past months some of the, well, nearly miraculous at least, things that God is able to do through us when we are open to the movements of God's Spirit and willing to put ourselves into God's dream rather than tenaciously hanging on to our own dreams. Some years ago, when I was in a supervisory position in the church, I was called to a particular place where the congregation to a particular church where the congregation was growing rapidly, and they had run out of room, and they had an idea for putting an addition on this church building that was landlocked and in a very small place. And they said, "We want to put an addition on the church out here into the parking lot." And I said, "That's a wonderful idea, but when you put the addition on the church, then where are you going to park? You're going to have more people. The church will be able to accommodate the growing congregation, but you're pushing them out of their parking space, and that will diminish the size of your congregation, no matter how big your building is, because there was no other place close by for people to park their cars." This was out in the country, but it was a mountainous area. They didn't have anything else they could do. And they said, "Well, we have some land out behind the parsonage that we think we could build a new church on. Let's go look." So we went to look, and, well, it was quite a sight. They had plenty of land, the acreage was wonderful, but it was one of the deepest gullies I've ever seen. It went from the house, which sat by the road, and the ground fell off as it went back away from the house. It fell off into a deep gully. How can you build something there? How can you possibly make that work? Plenty of acreage, but not situated in such a way as you could build something on it. But beside the house, the land went up to a beautiful knob, a small hill. And I said, right over there, there's the place to build a church. That way it could be seen in that location, it could be seen for miles. And people would have no trouble arriving at it. And you could use some of this land over here for the parking that you need. And they said, oh, we already thought of that. Someone else owns that land and he's going to build his house there on that beautiful knob where the church would look so good. I said, well, you need to submit that to prayer because I think that is what God might be moving you to do. And they were not at all pleased with me because I would not consent to any of their plans. But I saw another possibility, a more fitting possibility. The next week, the pastor called me and he said, Mike, I was inspired by what you said to us. So I called the man who owned that land and who has plans to build his house there. But he's decided to build that house elsewhere and he'll sell us that piece of ground that you were pointing us to. And that is today where the Knobsville Church stands on the Sidling Hill Parish in Fulton County. And here's the last thing to be said. You and I can have a part in the great things that God is doing. If we dream a dream for ourselves and our families, if we dream a dream for our church, and if it is truly God's dream, then remarkable things will happen and each of us will be a part of it. One of America's great churches is Grace Baptist Church in the city of Philadelphia. Dr. Russell Conwell built that church during his tenure as pastor. Conwell was the author of a book that has influenced millions of lives called Acres of Diamonds. He founded both the church and Temple University. During the height of his time there, Conwell preached to more than 4,000 people on Sunday mornings at Grace Baptist Church in Philly. But how the church, which was once called Baptist Temple, came to be built is not a well-known story. Hattie Wyatt was a little girl who went to Sunday school in the old building, which was located behind what is now Grace Baptist Church. One particular Sunday, when she went to Sunday school, she couldn't get in the door because there were too many children who wanted to go to Sunday school and the building was already full. Little Hattie went home disappointed, but she went home determined to do something about the problem. She began to save her pennies so a church building large enough for everyone could be built. Hattie saved until she had 57 cents, and then she became ill, and her illness deepened, and little Hattie did not survive. One day after she died, her broken-hearted mother took Hattie's 57 cents to Dr. Conwell at Grace Baptist Church and told him Hattie's story and how she had been saving for a new church building. Conwell was so deeply moved that he shared Hattie's vision with the congregation the next Sunday. And that 57 cents became the seed money for the raising of many thousands of dollars to build Grace Baptist Church. While that great building was being built, people called it Conwell's Folly. But they quit calling it that when it was finished and filled to capacity week after week. And the story doesn't end there. From Grace Baptist Church came Temple University, with its colleges of liberal arts and education in business and music and fine arts. It has graduate programs in many fields, including law and medicine and dentistry and pharmacy and medical technology. Its students number in the thousands, its graduates in the tens of thousands. But the church and the university owe their beginning to little Hattie Wyatt and her 57 cents. The dream that she had, that just happened to be congruent with God's great dream for that place at that time. Sound impossible? Not at all. It is simply the fulfillment of Christ's promise to the church. What is your dream for our church? Why not put Jesus to the test? Let's dream a dream for our church, a dream big enough that we will have to depend upon God and God's dream, and then let's go out and see that dream come true. After all, Jesus has promised, "Ask whatever you want in my name, and I will do it, that the Father may be glorified in the Son." All that's missing are people who are willing to dream God's dream and then work to make it happen. Amen.